It is 8:03. Paris is slowly moving towards recovery.
Now let's go back live to Paris. And Dan Manarino has been reporting all weekend and now into this week. Dan?
Yeah, good morning to you guys. It's 2 p.m. here, and we are starting to see things come back to normal. But with that, there is certainly a lot more security on the streets. It's inevitable. 100,000 more security and military on the presence here in Paris, according to terrorism experts that we spoke to. And that is specifically because you have that eighth suspect still on the loose. We have his picture for you, Salah Abdeslam, continuing to search for that individual believed to have been residing in an apartment just a few blocks away from where the attacks took place. Now, intelligence officials saying they're having a really tough time trying to crack into the system of communication for these terrorist groups, specifically the Islamic terrorist group. So joining me from New York this morning, we're going to continue this conversation, and is Stephen Rogers. We have a former intelligence officer and FBI National Joint Terrorism Task Force with us this morning. So, Stephen, thanks for joining us.
Good morning.
I want to ask you right off the bat that we're hearing how it's hard to communicate with these guys because they're using not only cryptic cell phones, but also Sony PlayStation devices where they're embedding themselves in video games to communicate. So how difficult is it really to crack into this system?
Well, to begin with, it's very, very difficult. The fact is that city police and local police do not have the technology or the capabilities to do any cyber investigations. That speaks to the issue of the NSA and the FBI. Look, there's been a lot of controversy before this attack regarding civil rights, rights to privacy versus the ability of the NSA to do their job. So we're going to have to look, we're living in extraordinary times. We're going to have to take extraordinary measures regarding the cyber technology and give the NSA what they need, the tools they need to crack these codes.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, you have ISIS now declaring that they're going to continue out attacks on places like New York and Washington. So how are U.S. intelligence officials, how are they going to prepare for something like this from your experience in the past?
Well, look, you got three components that we have to look at, the political, the military, and homeland defense. The political component is our leaders have to call ISIS what it is. Simple, clear, they're an enemy, we have to deal with them. The military component, strategic bombing of their command and control centers in the Mideast, their supply lines in the oil fields. And then finally, homeland defense. We must give the police the ability to do their job. Again, we go back to the issue of rights to privacy, search and seizure, stop and frisk. The only way you're going to combat this on the ground here in the United States, give the cops the ability to do their job, and they'll do it well.
And you know, Stephen, here on the streets of Paris, we have 100,000 extra police and military. Now, I'm sure that New York is going to, they're ramping up their counterterrorism efforts. What can New Yorkers expect to see on the streets for the next couple of days and weeks?
I'm sure you're going to see increased visibility of uniformed police officers. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of undercover police officers. But more importantly than anything else, and you said this on this station for as long as I remember, the people out on the streets are the most important intelligence gathering group that we have. You see something, you say something. So there'll be a lot of visibility regarding police manpower. But again, the people themselves are going to have to engage themselves with the police in this war on terrorism.
Of course, Stephen Rogers, thank you for joining us from New York this morning to talk more about this. And we appreciate you joining the program this morning.
You're welcome.